The day will come when, if you are to survive, you have to live together. It seems to me that it has to start with somebody who has been hurt and who will say, I can find it because of God in my heart to forgive. My greetings to all of you that are here tonight, because it was my privilege to be in this pulpit once before many years ago when I was starting out preaching. I had only been preaching a very short time, and I afflicted this congregation with one of my early sermons, and I'm sure that you never recovered. And to come back to Ireland and to come to Ulster and to Belfast at this particular time is also a great privilege, because I bring with me warm memories of many weeks spent here in years past. And I don't know how many more times I'll have the opportunity of coming to Ulster, but to see this beautiful country and the countryside, and to think a great deal of this church and this pastor, and of what you have contributed to the world, especially in the field of evangelism and missions. I seriously doubt if there is a people anywhere in the world that has contributed so much in personnel and prayer and interest and support than you have in the field of evangelism and missions around the world. A new world is being born. A new world sociologically, a new world technologically, a new scientific world is being born. But the greatest need at this moment is for the transformation of human nature. What causes the violence and the hate and the lying and the stealing and the hatred that's in the world today? North Ireland has received publicity around the world during the past few weeks. But violence here is nothing compared to some other parts of the world. I've come through all the problems of the south of the United States. That's where I live. And don't ever let an American point his finger at you. We cannot come here and tell you how to settle your problems. We can only tell you that we're on the way to the settlement of our problems, but we've had to do it through a spirit of Christian love. But we haven't settled it. And we may never settle it, I don't know. But I do know this, that God can settle any problem if we'll let him. Because you see, what I'm talking about involves all of us, because we've all broken God's law, and we're under God's judgment, and we're under the sentence of death. And Jesus said we must be born again. And the question I want to ask is, have you been born again? I was invited here by quite a cross-section of leadership in the city of Belfast and in Northern Ireland. It was my privilege also to talk to about 1,000 businessmen at a breakfast at the Wellington Hall.
Now, I know that we represent a cross-section of the community of Belfast. I know that there are many Protestants here and there are many Catholics here. And it reminds me of a story that I heard some time ago about a Baptist. Now, I happen to be a Baptist, and some of you don't know what a Baptist is, and sometimes neither do we. But a Baptist is not supposed to gamble. But this particular Baptist had gone to the racetrack because he loved to watch the horses run. And he said, I'm going to go and watch the horses run, but I'm not going to gamble. But he saw an interesting thing. He saw a Catholic priest praying over a horse, and that horse won the race. And that happened three times in a row. And he said, you know, this is not gambling. He said, this is a sure thing. So he watched the priest pray over another horse. And so he went and put all the money he had down on that horse. The horse ran around the track at the head of the pack, but suddenly it began to buck and shake and foam at the mouth, threw the jockey, and then the horse fell over dead. And the Baptist had lost all of his money. So he sought out the Catholic priest, and he said, Father, he said, I saw you pray over three horses, and they won, and you prayed over the fourth one. He didn't win, and he dropped dead. What happened? And the priest looked at him and said, you must be a Protestant. He said, yes. He said, I'm a Baptist, and I don't know too much about the Catholic Church. He said, well, if you had known something about the Catholic Church, you would have known the difference between a blessing and the last rites.
My most recent meeting was with the students at Queen's University, where they gave me a marvelous and wonderful reception.
Students all over the world are revolting against soulless materialism. In other words, materialism without a soul, materialism without a faith. The student world is being compelled in the United States to look seriously at the person of Jesus Christ. I saw a sign at a student meeting some time ago. They had a big sign that said Jesus was the first hippie. And some of them say that, well, they think of Jesus Christ as a revolutionary Christ, or they think of him as a hippie Christ, or they think of him as a madman, or they think of him as a deceiver. They think of him in all sorts of ways. But at least Jesus Christ has become inescapable to the student in the United States and the average university today. He's discussed in the classroom. He's discussed wherever students gather. 3 weeks ago, Paris Match had almost its entire magazine given over to the study of Jesus Christ. Who is this Christ that never traveled more than 30, or never lived more than 33 years and never traveled more than 100 miles, who never had any formal education, but in 1972 is causing a whole student generation to say, who are you? Who are you, Jesus Christ? And are you relevant to me and my generation? What are the things that you taught, and why were you executed? Did you really rise from the dead? Are you who they say you are? These are the questions that students are asking. And of course, students are asking what German philosophers are now calling the ultimate questions of life. Where did I come from? Why am I here? Where am I going? I'm involved in guilt. Why do I feel this sense of guilt? What is life all about? What is the purpose and the meaning of life? The Bible says that God created us in a perfect environment. And then he gave us a gift that he did not give his other creatures. He gave us the gift of freedom of choice. And God said, in this environment, you can live and build your world. There was no war, no hatred, no police, no armies, no jealousy, no lust, no greed. Man was to build a wonderful world, and God put a tree there, and he said, I'm going to test man. And man failed in the test. Well, the Bible says we're all infected. We're infected with a disease, a spiritual disease that I received from my parents. And it's been handed from generation to generation, and it causes the hatreds, the bigotries, the wars of history. And in our generation, we haven't been able to solve it. And I read something C.S. Lewis said some time ago, or before he died, that I thought about a long time. He said, war does not increase death. And at first it startled me, and then I began to think about it, and he's right. Death is total in every generation. Your generation will die. Another generation will take your place. My generation will die. You're the generation taking my place. Every generation dies. That is a result of this disease that we have. What can we do about the disease? How can we control it during our lifetime? And is there a life after death? That's becoming a great study at some of our universities. In fact, at the University of California, they've just instituted a subject on death. And it's so crowded that they have suddenly realized that they've touched on something that the student world is interested in, death. One out of every four pop songs deal with death. So they took a survey, and they found that among students, consciously or unconsciously, the student thinks about death an average of every 5 minutes. And yet not a single university in the United States was teaching people about death and how to die. And now they're trying to bring this up as a subject, and we may have a major in death pretty soon that you can take. There has developed in our world a vacuum. It's a philosophical vacuum, it's a religious vacuum. It's a political vacuum in some ways. And into that vacuum is going to move a demagogue who will come along with a hypnotic voice and lead the students as Hitler led them in Germany in the 30s. Unless we swing around and let Jesus Christ be our God and our Lord and our Master. God can give you the love and the understanding that is desperately needed at this hour, and we can have throughout the world a Christian revolution that could change the world. And we might have a generation of peace with that kind of a revolution. And it could start with you. Thank you, and God bless you.
I thought he was really good. He put it over with such a sense of love. And I think most people were very impressed.
Well, I think he really expressed what Jesus Christ means to young people today, and I think this is really what we need. You know, we need to get turned on with Jesus, and then all the hate and the fighting and the bigotry will stop.
Tremendous. Just the message for today.
They listened attentively, and then afterward there was a wonderful ovation, and I felt a great response to what I had to say. I talked on the needed revolution, and I talked about a spiritual revolution that could change the world and how that it could start with them.
I'm very glad, Dr. Graham, that you managed to meet the students and the young people of Northern Ireland, because they must be among our most worried people in the province at this time. And I'm sure you can sense the terrible worry and confusion that there is in Northern Ireland just now. And I can recall your visit here 10 years ago, and that was a time of apparent optimism. It was a time when we felt we were breaking through some of the difficulties in Northern Ireland. And now we're back in the midst of very real turmoil with an apparently terrible contrast. Now, looking back 10 years ago, Doctor, coming here now, what do you think has caused this difficulty?
Well, of course, when I was here 10 years ago, I flew in, gave one speech, and flew out. I did not even think about the problem at that time. And so it would be very difficult for me to compare. But of course, there seems to me to be a worldwide violence at the moment, that what is happening in Northern Ireland is happening in so many parts of the world. We've seen it in the United States on sort of a massive scale in many areas during the past 10 years.
We have this record of violence throughout the world. Ireland, the reputation of Ireland prior to our most recent troubles has been an isle of saints and scholars, a Christian island. Now here we have in Ireland apparently people who hate each other for the love of God and who seem not to be able to live the Christian message, that the vast majority of the people who profess to be Christians. How do you tie this up?
Well, I think you put your finger on it, Mr. Harkin, when you said professing Christians, because many of the wars of history have been fought in the name of Christianity, in the name of religion. And this is one of the great tragedies, because what we have is what we would call the church within the church. We have this vast group of people who call themselves Christians, but really do not know Jesus Christ as their Lord and their Master and their Savior. And they're not applying Jesus Christ and the teachings of Christ to their daily lives. And so you do have a professing Christendom who would say, if you stopped them on the street, are you a Christian? They would say, yes, I'm a Catholic or I'm a Protestant. But in actuality, according to the demands of Jesus Christ and the cost of following him, from the definition of the New Testament, they may be far from Christian.
This is surely a really serious indictment of the church organized, the organized church, because there's no doubt about it that as far as the population of Ireland is concerned, they have been more accessible to the church leaders. And yet, you know, at the end of us, and in a country which really is a good country in which to live, we find a situation where you are effectively saying that the message of Jesus hasn't been taught and hasn't been got across to the people.
It's not a matter of getting across, perhaps the people. Many of the people have not accepted the message. I mean, the message could be preached day after day by faithful clergy and faithful lay Christian witnesses, but the people haven't accepted it. Now, a percentage have, and a large percentage. There are thousands of true believers here in Northern Ireland that know Christ, but they may be a minority, because I was listening to some figures the other day, statistics of the number of people attending church, and I was quite appalled at the fact that the vast majority of the people of Northern Ireland do not go to church on a regular basis. And this may be one of the contributing factors, but I think there's another factor, and I think that we do have satanic activity. Every time that you have great religious movements, you also have the counter-reaction from the devil. Now, I believe in the devil. I believe there is a devil. I believe we're seeing in the United States today a great religious revival. But on the other hand, we're seeing a revival of violence and hate and prejudice. And I think that when God is moving and God is working in a certain place, you have the counter-activity of satanic forces that are also at work. And what you're seeing may be more than just two groups of people clashing. It may be back of this some satanic power that's stirring things up. And I think we must recognize that we're fighting not just flesh and blood, we're fighting against principalities and powers.
I think most Ulster people would agree with you that there's a devil at work amongst us at the moment. But there is a problem here of getting people together, Dr. Graham, and I'm glad you make the point that there is no holy war going on in Northern Ireland. Christians are not at war as such, but there is a need to bring Christians together, and particularly in Ireland. Now, there's a lot of people in Ireland, when they hear the word ecumenism, they reach for their theological revolver, as it were. Now, I'm wondering, in what way can we as Irish Christians come together? How do you, as an evangelist, preach the ecumenist message?
Well, I don't preach the message of the so-called ecumenical movement. I think there must be a distinction made between working together as citizens of a certain country and fellowshipping together in church services and worship services and so forth. And since I've been here, in all the talks that I've given, I insisted, and they faithfully carried out the fact that people from all groups were invited to attend and to participate. And when I looked out at these audiences, I couldn't tell the difference of what denomination or what group they came from. And I think that I stood, for example, on the peace line last Sunday morning, just about the worship hour. And on the one side, I saw a Catholic church with a cross on it. And on the other side, I saw a Presbyterian church with a cross on its steeple. And there was one Jesus Christ. He died on that cross for the sins of the whole world. He shed his blood for the sins of the whole world. And he loves us all equally. And whether we can ever come together and have the same worship services or not, there are great theological gulfs
but we should act like Christians toward each other. And we should, because the great characteristic of the Christian, by this shall all men know that ye are my disciples, in that ye have love one to another. And we are to love each other. And that's why I say that what is taking place in Northern Ireland appears to me, on the surface at least, not to be a religious war between Christians. There are great political overtones and other factors involved here. And I think the world has the impression that here are Christians at each other's throat. And it's not necessarily the Christians at each other's throat. There are many other factors involved that that appear to me, to at least, to be even greater than the religious question. Yes.
Well, Dr. Graham, I think you have been on record here as saying that you have no solutions to offer. You are obviously coming in as an outsider. Perhaps you can see the situation better than those of us who are living on the spot. Being perhaps the businessman on the panel, perhaps I'm meant to represent the more cynical in our midst here, I don't know. It could be said, if you like, to parody a phrase from the Bible, that man cannot live by Dr. Graham's good intentions alone, that the bread is also necessary. I think that while you have said that we must have a spiritual reawakening, I think there must be something practical done as well. Now, to continue perhaps to be slightly cynical, these crusades may be very good. I don't think you would term your visit here a crusade this time. But is the follow-up to this something which is going to be lasting? In other words, you may sow a few minor seeds, but does it finish there, or is there a continuation?
Well, I didn't really come here this time to have necessarily a ministry. I just came really to say that I love the people of Northern Ireland, both Catholic and Protestant, that I'm concerned, that I'm praying for them. And I came really to show my interest and to learn a bit, rather than to give speeches that I really wasn't aware that I was going to give this many public talks that I have given since I've been here. But I do feel that there is precedent here in Northern Ireland. In 1858, when things were very tense and very difficult, a great spiritual awakening came. There was no one man connected with it. Little prayer groups and Bible study groups sprang up everywhere. It affected both the Catholic and the Protestant population. Now, the thing, if I have a suggestion, it would be that if we could start having prayer groups and Bible study groups by the hundreds and even the thousands throughout Northern Ireland, where we didn't necessarily meet in a church building, but during the week, where neighbors could get together across all kinds of lines and say, well, we're just going to say a verse of scripture, we're going to read a passage, and we're going to have a prayer together, maybe a sentence prayer, maybe they've never prayed before. It's very difficult for people to have prejudice against each other and hate each other when they're praying together. And I think that part of the solution, not all the solution, there's got to be the work, the bread that you say, there's no doubt about it, but this is not my area to suggest. But now, I don't agree with many of my neighbors and friends religiously. We're on different sides of the fence, but we're friends and we love each other as fellow citizens and as fellow human beings.
Well, it is said that where there is no vision, the people perish. I think that in Northern Ireland, 98% or probably more of the people are all striving desperately for peace. Is it the fact that the 1 or 2% of extremists who are not prepared to let us have peace have got a vision which the other 98% are lacking?
Well, I don't know that much about the situation to comment on. I would say that from our experience in the United States, and I'm a Southerner, I come from the southern part, as you can tell perhaps from my accent of the United States, that we are on the road to settling our problems, and we've made great strides in the last 10 years, but we still do have some extremists to the extreme left and the extreme right who still would like to bring about confrontation and troubles. Whether that's true here in Northern Ireland would not be for me to say, because I haven't been here long enough to be able to make an authoritative statement along that line.
And indeed, we are praying very hard in Ulster at the moment, Doctor, and the churches, in fact, are rallying behind a very great peace initiative, and some of the movements in the scene at the moment are certainly coming from this spiritual revival, as it were. But at the end of the day, we've still got to build a new society together here and in a good many other countries. Now, I know you're not a politician, but at the same time, it is a question of one's relationship with one's neighbour. What kind of rules about this relationship would you think are necessary if we're going to build a new Ulster and indeed a new society?
Well, I would like to limit my comment to America, if I might, yes. Where I'm much more knowledgeable. There's no doubt that we have had in America terrible social injustice. These injustices had to be righted. And then secondly, we had to meet on a spiritual plane. And then the political rights of all groups had to be recognized, because we are a much more pluralistic society than you are. We have every type of minority group in the country. And even the political parties, let's say the Democratic Party, of which I am a Democrat, we had to form new rules this year to see that all minority groups were represented in the choosing of the Democratic nominee for president. And of course, this brings about great problems, and it brings about a great many difficult feelings on the part of people who have been entrenched for a long time. Now, how that would apply to Ulster, I don't know. I mean, I would not want to comment on the situation in Ulster politically, because I don't know that much about it. I'm telling you our experience in the United States, where we've had to deal with this thing, and we're far from solving it, I must say. I'm not coming with saying that we've solved it. I think we're headed in the right direction, let's say.
You're saying that, then, Dr. Graham, that one of the first ingredients that must be put into the pie is social justice. You must start to tackle the problem from this basis.
I would say that first of all, Jesus said, "Thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, mind, and soul, and thy neighbor as thyself." Sometimes we get the cart before the horse. We say to everybody, we take a club and say, "You love each other." Well, they don't have the capacity to love each other. The traditions and the feelings and the prejudices are too deep. What you say is love God, have an experience with God first. Then he gives you the capacity to love your neighbor. And I have seen, for example, in the United States, I'm thinking of a man now that was one of the so-called leading racial bigots in America, well known. And he was converted to Jesus Christ. Now he's going all over the country preaching racial love and racial tolerance and racial understanding. But first he had to have his experience with Christ. And when he had this experience with Christ and was converted to Christ, it changed his whole outlook toward people of the other race.
Dr. Graham, there is one point here which I think you have a similar issue in the United States, and that's the question of integrated education. You have this busing issue in fact, it's one of the issues in the presidential elections, as far as I know, at the present time. I think there is a parallel in the Northern Ireland situation here. Many of us feel that there are going to be two separate communities unless there is integrated education from an early stage. I wouldn't expect you to comment on that in the light of the Northern Ireland situation, but perhaps you could describe the situation as it appertains in America. I know there has been resistance to this.
I don't think there's too much resistance to the integrated education. I think the resistance has come from both black and white, I might say, to taking a child that's across the street from a perfectly good school and busing him 21 miles away, that takes 2 hours to get there because they stop so many times, and 2 hours back. And the black parents have been just as much upset as the white parents over this, simply because they didn't want their children going that far away from home. And I don't think the resistance has been so much to... Now, it was 10 years ago. Now I think we're over the hurdle. Everybody recognizes that integration in education is here to stay, and it's a good thing in the United States. But I do think that the vast majority of American people feel that to send people 20-some miles away just to achieve racial balance is not contributing to the good education of the children. What we need are equal schools and quality education that is thoroughly integrated. But they need to be a little closer to home, perhaps. This is the thinking, I think, of the majority of Americans.
Doesn't that tie up, indeed, with the position, perhaps, in Northern Ireland, where there are ghettos, both colored ghettos in America, Catholic and Protestant ghettos in Northern Ireland. And the problem then arises that if you don't have people living together, if you integrate people, there's a great deal of talk in Northern Ireland about integrated education and very little talk about integrating people. I wonder to what extent there has been a real attempt on the part of people in America to integrate black and white in the neighborhoods in which they live. Then, of course, the integrated education would follow from an integrated community.
One of the problems in America that we're going to have to face realistically is if we're going to have an integrated society, we are going to have to integrate our communities. And this is going to be a very, very difficult thing to do, especially in the northern part of the country where people they work together in the daytime but go home to separate communities at night. And how to overcome it is the great problem, I think, that America is going to have to face in the next 25 years. And it's going to take a long time. You can't turn the Queen Elizabeth around in the mid-Atlantic on just a coin. It takes time to do. And I don't think that, for example, when Nehemiah went back and built the walls of Jerusalem, it only took him 52 days. I doubt if you're going to solve the problems here of many centuries in 52 days.
We have a situation, though. You say that people work together, you see, and go home and live in separate communities. Unfortunately, over large areas of industry in Northern Ireland, even this doesn't happen. You know, where we have integration or segregation in workplaces, and where we have some places where only people of a particular religion will work at all. Now, how do we tackle this sort of thing? How do you to get down to a situation where you have fair employment practices? Have you had this experience in America?
Yes, definitely. How have you gone about it? The fair employment situation has been tackled very courageously by both the government and the unions and by business. And one of the problems that business faces in the United States is getting enough black people to meet their quotas.
Could you tell us a little about the healing problems here, Doctor? Because though America isn't Ulster, you've shared some of our problems. And we have had approaching 400 people killed here and I suppose 5,000 people injured. And there's been a great wall of distrust built up as a result of this. Now, we're going to have to rebuild here, and we're determined to rebuild. But what about this healing process? How do we start structuring trust again between people who have been brutally thrust asunder?
Well, Mr. Blakely, you have been to Kenya, as we were talking earlier. And I don't know whether you remember, but when Mr. Kenyatta became the Prime Minister of Kenya,
yes.
And many people had thought that he was the leader or one of the leaders of Mau Mau, and there was all this feeling of distrust and prejudice and hatred back and forth, and many people had been injured. And you remember the first broadcast he gave to the nation, in which he said into the microphone, he said, you have hurt us for a long time. He was talking to the white settlers, yes, who were fleeing rapidly. And he said, we have hurt you. Now he said, and he paused, and very dramatically, he said, I forgive you. And then he paused again, and he said, will you forgive me? And it said that all through Kenya, it just went like an electric shock to the people, because he challenged them to a great Christian principle of forgiveness. Now, whether that solved all the problems of Kenya, we know they've had many problems since, but it seems to me that somewhere, it has to start with somebody who has been hurt and who will say, I can find it because of God in my heart to forgive.
Dr. Graham, I think one of the problems in the north of Ireland is that the events of the last few years have meant that there is now very little room for the moderates. I realize we haven't much time left to discuss this, but what would your advice be to those who have always been moderate in their opinions and who are finding it increasingly hard to maintain this moderate opinion?
I was a moderate during the early 50s in America, and I know exactly what you're talking about, because I was hit from both angles. Both the right and the left attacked me very viciously. Because I stood for racial understanding and racial reconciliation at a period when Many people on both sides felt that one should go further, either to the left or to the right. But I maintained my position, and I've lived to see the day when I believe that that my position has been understood. For example, I spoke to the church, and I wrote an article in the Reader's Digest back in the early 50s in which I said the most segregated hour of the week I called 11 o'clock Sunday morning in the church. And I called upon the churches to take the lead in this matter of racial understanding, because there were hundreds of churches that would not allow a black man to worship in the church. That day, I'm glad to say, is passing very rapidly. But I do understand it's a very difficult position to maintain. And if one can stand and have love and a feeling of reconciliation, because no matter how it's settled, the day will come at an X point when, if you are to survive, you have to live together.
Wee Davy Shaw, he's 7, asked his mother, "Why can't I go to church with Pat O'Shea? Pat's church is just around the corner and mine is more than half a mile away." "You can't go to his church," his mother told him. "Pat's a Roman Catholic, you're a prod." "Is that the reason?" Davy asked in wonder. "Then Catholics have a different God." "Their God's the same as ours," his mother told him, "but they worship in a slightly different way." "Then I could do it that way too," says Davy. "And sure I could learn it all from Pat O'Shea." Wee Davy Shaw, he's 7, asked his mother, "Why can't I go and play with Pat O'Shea? Pat's house is just around the corner and all my friends live half a mile or more away." His mother gently put her arms around him. She said, "I know wee Pat's a very decent kid. Now, I wouldn't mind you playing with him, but your daddy wouldn't like it if you did." But that night, Davy's mother asked her husband, "Why can't wee Davy go and play with Pat O'Shea?" He said, "Because we can't get friendly with them Fenians, whatever what our friends and neighbors say." But in his heart, he knew that was no answer. And next night in the pub, we heard him say, "A prod is a prod, and a Catholic is a Catholic. So why can't wee Davy go and play with Pat O'Shea?" I shook my head. I couldn't give an answer. "It's not your fault or mine," I said to him. "If that's the way your friends and neighbors want it, don't ask me the question. You ask them." Two tiny kids who only want to laugh and play together, but their fathers won't allow it. They're afraid. Afraid of all the jibes and taunts of some bitter bigots. What sort of bloody country have they made?
We've talked about the problems of both America and Northern Ireland and the rest of the world. And it does seem that the world is heading towards some sort of a crisis that's going to involve us all, because we now have weapons that could destroy the human race in a matter of minutes or hours at the most. And I believe that if there's ever a time that we need reconciliation between all peoples around the world, of all ethnic groups and all nationalities and religious opinions, it's now. That doesn't mean that I give up my own religious belief, which is very strong, and I would die for my faith in Jesus Christ. But I can love a person who may not accept Jesus Christ. In fact, God loved the world when we were in rebellion against him. He loved the whole world. And he loved sinners so much that he sent his son to die on the cross for the sinners. And I wonder if we shouldn't have this type of love toward people that we might have great disagreements with, both politically, religiously, or we may have a different color skin, different cultural backgrounds, different traditions, but we're to have love for each other. And it seems to me that this is a result of our personal relationship with Jesus Christ as Christians. And I know it's difficult. I know that sometimes it strains us to the utmost. And we can't produce this love ourselves. This love has to be given to us by the Holy Spirit. And the scripture says that the fruit of the Spirit is love and joy and peace and 6 other fruits of the Spirit. But the primary one is love.
and this love thinks no evil and is gentle and kind, even in the midst of adversity. And the greatest example is when our Lord was on the cross and he was being executed, and he said, "Lord, forgive them. They know not what they do." And I wonder if that may be a place that we could start, starting at the cross, in accepting Jesus Christ as our Lord and Master and Savior.
Billy Graham, glad to see you. How are you? Yeah, take one of my stickers.
Yes, sir.
It says, "Smile, God loves you."
I think that many times as we study history, people have to reach bottom before they can start up. And I think that perhaps that moment is almost upon you in Northern Ireland. And I leave Northern Ireland with a great deal of hope. There are certain straws in the wind now that would give me hope that this problem is going to be settled peacefully. At least that's my prayer.
Bye, and God bless you. Thank you.